all, this is Dr. Kathleen Alsup, and I'm going to provide a quick overview of the pancreas. The goals of this lecture are to provide you with the scaffolding to really better prepare you for the anatomy dissection experience. But as you know, sometimes those don't always align exactly with the clinical and other basic science lectures, so we wanted to provide you the basics here first. Let's get started in terms of getting a better understanding of where the pancreas is located. The pancreas is rather deep in terms of its placement, and the majority of this particular organ is going to be what's referred to as retroperitoneal. And I have an asterisk here. Most resources you'll see that the pancreas is exclusively retroperitoneal, and that's true. The majority of the organ is. But I want to note right here, and you can see it better in this particular image, that the tail of the pancreas is very closely associated with the spleen. We know the spleen is an intraperitoneal organ. Therefore, the tail of the pancreas is as well. So everything from about here on is going to be retroperitoneal, and it makes sense. You have this very close relationship to the kidneys, but the tail of the pancreas is going to be considered intraperitoneal. The pancreas is an accessory digestive gland, so really thinking about that exocrine function, those pancreatic enzymes, but you will also have an endocrine function that's very important in terms of the pancreas, in terms of the secretion of insulin. So let's better understand the parts of the pancreas. The head of the pancreas, you can see right here, fitting right into this C-shaped portion of the duodenum. This is the thickest portion of the pancreas, and it's on its way to opening into the descending part of the duodenum. So the bile duct lies in a groove on the posterior superior surface of the head. And really, it's embedded right within that parenchyma, the pancreas. The uncinate process, which you can see a little bit right here, also affords a very close relationship with the duodenum. This is actually just a projection of that inferior part of the head. And this portion, the uncinate process, really develops separately in utero from the rest of the gland. So it does have a slightly different appearance than the rest of the head of the pancreas. The neck, which we don't have labeled in this image, but it's right about here. The neck, as any good neck does, is located between the head and the body of the pancreas. It is really important due to its relationship to the hepatic portal vein, which is, it's located anterior to that hepatic portal vein. So if you have any issues in terms of the parenchyma of the pancreas, it could actually affect the portal vein deep to it. The body of the pancreas is the longest part and is considerably thinner than the head. Its superior portion is very closely related to the celiac trunk and its branch, the splenic artery, which you can see right here. We always say that splenic artery has a very tortuous relationship. It's kind of a squiggly artery right here. Very large, which makes sense because it's going to supply the spleen. Posterior to the body, it's related to the SMA, or your superior mesenteric artery, the aorta, and even portions of the left kidney. And you can see a fairly large tail in this particular individual of the pancreas. It's not always quite that large, but it's very closely related to the hilum of the spleen. And as I discussed before, this is considered intraperitoneal. Now, if we're looking back at the head, again, of the pancreas, this is really where you're going to see the bulk of the pancreatic ducts. Now, pancreatic ducts transport that exocrine material of the pancreas, so those pancreatic fluids. And that eventually needs to make its way to the descending or second part of the duodenum. The major duct of the pancreas is referred to as the main pancreatic duct. Sometimes you just see it referred to as the pancreatic duct. And you'll really find it in your dissection, traveling from the tail of the pancreas all the way towards the head of the pancreas. And this is the duct that's going to join with the common bile duct to enter into the duodenum. And this joining will form a dilation. You can see it very well in this particular image. This dilation right here is referred to as the hepatopancreatic ampulla. And this is opening into that second part via the major duodenal papilla. So the major duodenal papilla would be right in this region. Commonly, there is also what's referred to as an accessory pancreatic duct, so very much involved with the head of the pancreas. And you can see here, this is a really nice example, these ducts often communicate. The fluids transported by the accessory pancreatic duct enter the duodenum via the minor duodenal papilla. So you would have the major duodenal papilla here, the minor duodenal papilla here. So that's going to be superior to the major. So typically, that's going to be the typical pattern. Sometimes you'll have no communication. Every once in a while, the accessory pancreatic duct is actually larger than the major, but this is the typical pattern here. Now, I know this particular slide seems a little overwhelming, and the arterial supply of the pancreas can seem overwhelming, but really, these names really explain exactly where they're supplying. So if we can kind of get over the length of the name, I think you'll actually find that it's very explanatory of what it's supplying. We can really divide the arterial supply into what supplies the head and the neck and what supplies the body and the tail. So we're going to start with the head and the neck, and also the head and the neck of the pancreas shares a supply with the duodenum, which makes sense based on its very close relationship. The head and the neck of the pancreas are going to be supplied by the celiac trunk, which you can see here, so branches of that celiac trunk, and branches of the superior mesenteric artery, whereas the body and the tail are going to be supplied exclusively by that splenic artery. So let's get into a bit more details in terms of the head and the neck supply. On both sides of the head and neck region, there are what we call arterial arcades. And really what that is just a network of anastomosing arteries. And we're going to start, both these arcades are going to have what's referred to as superior and inferior branches, and they're coming from the celiac trunk or the SMA. So let's start with the anterior pancreatico-duodenal arcade. The anterior superior branch, which you can see right here, is derived from the gastroduodenal artery. And the gastroduodenal artery is one of the terminal branches of the common hepatic artery. And if you think back to just the basics of the celiac trunk, that's one of the three main branches of the celiac trunk. So the source is going to be celiac for these superior branches. Whereas when we're talking about the anterior inferior branches, these are going to be derived from the inferior pancreatico-duodenal arteries, and these are a direct branch off of that SMA. So one of your first branches, in fact, of your superior mesenteric artery. The posterior pancreatico-duodenal arcade is similarly organized with the posterior superior branches from gastroduodenal and the posterior inferior branches from the inferior pancreatico-duodenal, or your SMA. So don't forget, it's very important to note that these arteries not only supply this head and neck region, but also the duodenum. That's thus the name pancreatico-duodenal. It's really less complex in terms of the rest of the pancreas, so these are all going to be derived from branches from the splenic artery. The dorsal pancreatic artery is really the largest branch that we're going to see typically, and it's generally one of the first, if not the first, branch off the splenic artery. And it will continue inferiorly as the inferior pancreatic artery. So you can see it extending right here, and as its name would suggest, on that inferior portion of the body. Unlike its name would suggest, the greater pancreatic artery is actually not particularly large. It's a bit more lateral of a branch from the splenic artery that's going to supply the more lateral portions of the body. But the very aptly named artery of the tail of the pancreas is the main supply for the tail of the pancreas, but also coming off of the splenic artery. Now, in your dissections, these arteries are often easier to locate on the posterior side of the pancreas. The venous drainage is considerably easier to understand after a discussion of the arteries. There will be similarly named veins and tributaries to what we have with the arteries, and they're all draining into that hepatic portal system. So not into the systemic system, but into the hepatic portal system. Lastly, we can't forget innervation. Like most of the viscera in this area, the pancreas has both parasympathetics derived from the vagus nerves, innervation, as well as sympathetic innervation from those thoracic splanchnics, particularly that greater splanchnic and the lesser splanchnic. And as in most of the functions, parasympathetics is going to be secretomotor, And sympathetics will be vasoconstrictors in terms of the vasculature associated with the pancreas. In common with other foregut structures, the majority of pain arising from the pancreas is referred to the epigastrial region. So remember, that's just anterior to the stomach or the central superior abdominal area. So this concludes the overview of the pancreas. For additional information and images, please refer to the BlueLink website.